first thought that was a dog laying there.
Good morning. Hope everybody's doing well this morning. As you can see, and as you can hear when you came in, Miss Carrie's not here. So I feel like my right arm is cut off, but I have my left arm here, so we're still good. Okay, we're ready to praise and worship this morning. So let's all stand as we sing. This is Amazing Grace.
Done for me. forgive us as brothers and sisters to come together and worship you and praise you. Father, we ask that you just show your presence today mightily, Lord. Just have your way in our service. Be with every aspect, the singing, the preaching, the praying, all that we do, my Father, here today. And we're just going to give you the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
You may be seated. We're going to be singing a good bit about grace this morning. And you know, when we think about grace, grace is the whole, everything that's behind, our salvation. The fact that, God granted us grace by sending his son to die on the cross for us. He didn't have to do it. And we definitely didn't deserve it. But how often do we extend grace to other people? You know, a lot of times in school, especially at the beginning of the school year, a student will bring in a late paper or something like that should have been turned in like 2 weeks ago, and it's like the day before grades are due. And I'll be like, okay, this is your one grace. Like, there's a limit to my grace for their grades. But think about with God. There is no limit. There is no limit. His grace is free to us. There's nothing we can't earn it in any way. And, I'm so appreciative of Christians, friends and stuff who show their grace to me. You know, I can laugh about it now. I wasn't laughing about it then, but I was supposed to come and practice Friday with Will and Jessica. And Jessica gives me a call about 7:20. She's like, "Tina, you coming?" or text me. And I happened to be at UAB with my dad at the emergency room. And he was having a few little issues, and I was just like, oh my goodness, I completely forgot. She's like, no, don't worry, And it bothered me a whole lot more, I think, than it bothered her, but it was grace. And then I got tickled, because later on, she had posted something about having to wait almost 50 minutes for fast food at a local restaurant. I knew which one she was talking about. She didn't put it, though. She had to show grace right there. But think about that. A lot of times, we get agitated waiting, and there's reasons why we're waiting. We may be impatient about something, but sometimes there's things going on, and we need to show grace to other people. And because of the fact that, our Heavenly Father shows us so much grace. So let's continue singing about grace this morning with grace that is greater than our sin. Don't wait for Miss Carrie to start.
Marvelous grace of our love.
Marvelous, infinite, matchless. Singing a song.
But why are you singing that song?
Well, so I won't forget how to breathe. Breathe in, breathe out.
So you won't forget how to breathe?
I forget things easily. There must be a screws in there somewhere. Breathe in, breathe out.
Well, that's just...
Well, if I don't sing that song, then I won't remember to breathe. Breathe in, breathe out.
You know, the letters of the alphabet, we use to spell things.
Oh, that one. Yeah, here's how I remember the alphabet. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P.
We get it.
Q, R, S, T, U, V.
We understand.
W, X, Y, Z.
Okay.
Now I said the alphabet. I'll do it again so I don't forget.
Hold it. We get the idea.
Oh, sorry.
Well, thank you, Leonardo, but it's time to go then.
Oh, I know another song.
But we've got to go.
Please.
All right, but it better be important.
Oh, it's important, all right. I have a song that helps me remember the Lord's Prayer.
You know the Lord's Prayer?
Yep, the whole thing.
Wow, even I have trouble remembering the Lord's Prayer.
This is so important, you've got to let me teach it to you. This is the Lord's Prayer, Matthew 6, 9 through 13. Say your prayer both day and night, and even in between. All right now, everybody, repeat after me. Our Father who art in heaven.
Our Father who art in heaven.
Hallowed be your name.
Hallowed be your name.
Your kingdom come.
Your kingdom come.
Your will be done.
Your will be done.
On earth as it is in heaven.
On earth as it is in heaven.
Hold it. You sound really good. And I ain't lying. Oh, where was I? Oh, yeah. This is the Lord's Prayer, Matthew 6, 9 through 13. Say the prayer both day and night, and even in between. All right now, everybody, come on, repeat after me. Give us this day our daily bread.
Give us this day our daily bread.
And give us our debts.
Give us our debts.
As we forgive our debtors.
As we forgive our debtors.
And lead us not.
And lead us not
into temptation.
Into temptation.
Deliver us from evil.
Deliver us from evil.
This is the Lord's Prayer, Matthew 6, 9 through 13. Say a prayer both day and night, and even in between. For yours is the kingdom.
Yours is the kingdom.
And power and the glory.
And power and the glory.
Forever.
Forever.
This is the Lord's Prayer, Matthew 6, 9 through 13. Say a prayer both day and night, and even in between. This is the Lord's Prayer, Matthew 6, 9 through 13. Say a prayer both day and night, and even in between. And now let's finish with a big amen. 1, 2, 3, amen.
Amen.
Wow, that was great. Now we'll all remember the Lord's Prayer. Take a bow, Leonardo. Wow.
How do I do that? Oh, yeah, I remember. In over and bow. That's it.
We gotta get him some help this way.
Thank you, Leo Lyon, for teaching us the Lord's Prayer this morning. Let's all stand as we continue with Amazed. You dance over me. Never hear the sound, Lord, I'm amazed.
morning. I just wanted to share a couple of things before we begin this song. First of all, the devil is working hard this morning, I guess, because right before we were practicing, George's acoustic part that he hooks up to the amp went out, okay? And there's just some trials that have gone on this week that I just feel like, you know, that he's working against. And during this week, we were thinking that we were going to be singing about Amazing Grace. We're actually going to sing Amazing Grace, but God put this on my heart to share this song this morning. I want to share a little bit. I can't share too much because I'll be professional. I wonder where I get that from. But many of you know that I'm a nurse, and I have been working with some of these patients. And there was one day in particular that was very rough. We were very short-staffed. Morale is very, very low right now because, you know, we're dealing with sick people. And that's what we're supposed to do is we help people, right? We help people get better. But sometimes people don't get better. But this one in particular morning, everything that could possibly go wrong was going wrong. And I had a meltdown. I went in the break room and I bawled my eyes out. Just bawled my eyes out. And I spoke to my boss and she came in there and some of my coworkers were like, hey, Jess, you know, it's going to be all right. It's going to be okay. Just why don't you gather yourself up, take a few minutes. And so I did. Sat down, got me something to drink. And then I don't know if you've ever had God speak to you so hard that it's almost like you can actually literally hear him talking to you. But that was the experience that morning. It said, get back in there, daughter. You're doing my work. And so while we can't possibly, you know, while we don't have the answer, we're looking for answers with medical professionals. I have the cure, because the cure is Jesus Christ. And these people are looking for hope. They're looking for something, and I have that, and I can get that to them. So I just want to encourage all of you, throughout whatever your job is, if it's a teacher, if it's in the office, as we go about, if there's so much uncertainty these days, you have it inside you. Share it. They're looking for us. They're looking at the church for light. Let's be that light.
Jesus, the name.
was going to say, someone on that side, I'm not going to mention any names, said I needed only to be up here 15 minutes, and someone else said around 20 minutes. So I'm going to just kind of please everybody and add it together and be up here about 35 minutes, if that's okay. Amen? So Matthew chapter 5, we're going to be there. You know, the Bible tells us that this is the day the Lord has made. And we will rejoice and be glad in it. You know, and I love that verse because to me it shows me that God not only made this day, that he not only ordained this day or created this day, but he made this day for us, for you and for me. And I take it personal, I really do, because he made this day for me. And he told me that I'm supposed to rejoice in it, and I'm supposed to be glad in it. You know, it's a privilege and an honor to come and be around God's people. You know, he made this day for us, so we can come and worship him and sing songs about him and hear God's word and the fellowship with other brothers and sisters in Christ. That's why he tells us to enter his gates with thanksgiving in our hearts. You know, that's from the Psalms, by the way, Psalm 100, verse 4. But he says, come into his presence with thanksgiving. Because you know what? In his presence is where we find life. And his presence is where we find that amazing grace and that mercy and that love and that joy and that peace that only he can give. So it's an honor and a privilege to be here in God's house this morning. So Matthew chapter 5, starting around verse 13. Matthew 5, verse 13 says, you are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. So let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who's in heaven. You know, I was thinking, you know, the ability to be flexible is a special thing. It's one of those unique qualities and traits that we can have. You know, as we see around the world today in our own nation, people just don't seem to be flexible, do they? That there doesn't seem to see any yielding or any compromise. There's a lot of rigid people out there. I remember when I was growing up, there was a phrase that they said, my way or the highway. Now, do they still say that? You know, I don't work anymore, so I don't hear that anymore. But that word flexible, it means to be able to adapt. To adapt to a new or a different or some changing requirements or different surroundings. You know, lately, we've had to do a lot of adapting, haven't we? You know, we have. You know, as individuals, we have to adapt. As a church, we've had to adapt. In our everyday life, we've had to adapt. You know, we're doing things different now. You know, they're calling it a new normal change. You know, we're having to wear face masks, social distancing, but we're seeing church online. You know, it's a whole different deal. You know, but we've had to adapt and change. Like in my own life, the past 5 years, I had to do a lot of adapting and had to be flexible, especially in the last year that I had to go through. Now that word rigid is just the opposite of being flexible. You know, it means that we're not, there's no exceptions or loosening of any standards. We have to be rigid on what we believe in that. And there's times we need to be flexible in life, there are. And there's times that we need to be rigid in our lives, especially in our Christian life, in our Christian walk. And we need to know when to be flexible. And we need to know when to be rigid. You know, the Bible tells us that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and that no man cometh unto the Father except by him. Now, we got to be rigid on that fact. We can't change that at all. Jesus is the way. He is the truth, and he is the life. He's not just a way, a truth, and a life. He is the way, the truth, and the life. And we got to be rigid on that fact. It says that whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's why in Acts it says there's no other name under heaven. No other name under heaven by which man can be saved. We got to be rigid on that fact. We've got to be rigid on the fact that Jesus lived a sinless life, that he was crucified, that he died and was buried, and that he rose again. See, if we change any of that's changing our own Christian beliefs. The resurrection of Jesus, the inerrancy of Scripture, we've got to believe all of that and be rigid on that. But there are times that we do need to be flexible in our lives. There are. There's times, especially as Christians, in our everyday life, there's times we need to be flexible. Not as a coach, right? If you're out there and the game's not going the way it's supposed to be, you might have to alter a few changes, you know, to make it different. If your starting pitcher or your starting quarterback isn't living up to what they're supposed to be living up to, you might have to change the game plan. But Did you know that? That in this day and age, you know, I've learned that when people are going through problems, when people are going through drastic changes in their life or they're dealing with things in their life, that they're actually more flexible and they're more open to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Did you know that? You know, you talk to people and everything's just going great in their life and you want to tell them about Jesus. Sorry, everything's going okay. I don't need that Jesus that you're talking about. But let them have a problem. Let something go on in their lives, and all of a sudden, they're willing to listen to it. You know, I talked to a few people over the past couple of months, just in casual conversations, and I've had people kind of ask me, do you believe we're living in the last days? I mean, do you believe Jesus is coming back soon? See, that they're flexible, that they're open to what you have to say. So we need to be ready and be able to be flexible enough to reach people where they are. And not flexible with the word. We've got to be rigid on the fact. You know, sometimes you're going to tell people, this is what the word of God says, and I'm not going to bend on that whatsoever. But there's times we need to be able to be flexible enough to share that word. You know, I tell you, when I shared the gospel of Jesus in a lot of different places, other than a church setting, I've shared the gospel in someone's car before, in their driveway, you know, in their garage, standing in their garage, their walkway. I shared the gospel on the street, talking to people on a street corner, but believe that or not, hospital rooms, nursing homes, emergency rooms, workplaces. I sat at someone's kitchen table and shared the gospel, you know, in the living room, wherever it is. That's been more times than in a church building. So we've got to be flexible. We've got to be able to be flexible wherever they are. Now, if we just read those scriptures, and then Jessica was talking about that, we got to be the light of the world, don't we? We have to be. You're the light of the world. I'm the light of the world. This church is the light of the world. Christians are the light of the world. And we need to be that light because in the darkest moments of someone's life is where the light shines the brightest, isn't it? That means we got to be influencing. As a church, we have to be an influencing factor. As Christians, we have to be. We got to be available and flexible. Let our light shine wherever that may be. Because it says there, a city or a church or a Christian that's set on a hill can't be hidden. You know, we've got to be seen, especially in these days and times that we're living in. We've got to be seen more than ever before. What good is a light if it's turned off, right? Well, what good is a light if someone can't see it, especially if someone's searching for it? And believe me, people are searching. They may be searching in wrong places. That they may be searching for other answers. But like she said, we have the answer. People are searching, and we got to be ready to give those answers because the light draws people like a beacon. And another thing, the hill is actually a vantage point. It's the best place to be. So if our light is on top of the hill, it's the best place for someone to see it. Now, as we look around today, you know, we're seeing all these things happening. Things are happening in the world. Things are happening in America. Things are happening in our own state, in our own homes, and in our own lives. And believe it or not, we're fighting battles right now. There's a lot of battles kind of going on. Some of us in here right now are going through some physical battles, aren't we? But there's some of us in here that are dealing with emotional battles right now. And if you're a Christian this morning, each and every one of us are going through a spiritual battle. I mean, it's just the way it is. Christians have to fight those spiritual battles. Ephesians 6:12 says, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of darkness, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. We're fighting battles this morning. And as we fight those battles, you know, we have to be trained. We have to be ready. We got to be ready and trained to be able to fight these battles that we are facing every day. Now, I remember being in the Marines and the military, you know, they instilled in us all the time training, didn't they? Train, train, train. That's all we did was train. Because they knew the training set us up for success. The training set us up for those victories that we had to do. They said, train, learn it, retain it, remember it, practice it, and then they said, train some more, even though you think you have it. Because someday you're going to need that training. They said, guarantee, one day you're going to need that training because one day it's going to come and you're going to have to look and say, oh, I've got this training. I'm ready to go into those battles. Because they told us, when you get into the middle of a battle, it's too late to train then. It's too late to study then you know. You're not going to learn it then. See, you're going to have to rely on your training at those times to get you through. And that's not just for the military or Marines, but that's for Christians, especially for Christians today. Because we're finding ourselves today in battles, aren't we? You know, the world is fighting against us. Our own nation is fighting against us. It just seems like our own bodies are fighting against us. There's constant battles that we deal with. So when we find ourselves in these situations that are real and not practiced, see, that's when we're truly tried. That's when we're put to the test, and that's when our training pays off. So we need to get that training. That's why we have to rely on what we know. But when those battles come, we have to rely on what we were instructed and what we were taught and what we learned. You know, in sports, they train over and over again, don't they? They just constantly train. They kind of practice these plays over and over until they become second nature. I remember when I was in the military, that's all we did was train. And things that we didn't even understand why we were doing it. You know, we had to train digging foxholes, train how to crawl on the ground so we didn't get shot. We had to train how to do this and how to do that. And I remember we had to train constantly how to take our weapon apart and put it back together. And we had to do it so good they would even blindfold us. And so we could learn how to take it apart and put it back together in the dark. And we practiced every possible scenario that we would face in battle. And you know why? Because they knew we were going to need it someday. And it had this become second nature to us. And I still remember this day. So long ago that I was in boot camp, but I remember they would come up to you, the drill instructors would just come up to you at random and ask you a question. And you never knew what that question was going to be. And they would ask everybody a different question. But when they came up to you, they'd ask you a question. And if you didn't know the answer, after they beat you, but besides that, you had to tell them, sir, I was given instruction, I was taught that, but I don't know the answer. And the reason they did that is to show, look, if we don't learn, it's our fault. We can't blame anybody else in life if we don't have the answer. You know, lately we've had to go through things, haven't we? We've gone through things today in our country and in our church and as individuals that we could never even imagine. You know, five, six months ago, someone had said this was going on, we would never have believed it, would we? I'll tell you, even in my own life, just to kind of bring it a little closer, I had to deal with so much in the past 6 or 7 months. You know, I've had to deal with the same things you're dealing with, the pandemics, the normal wear and tear of life. But I had to deal with the death of my mother a couple of months ago. I had to deal with Medicare and Medicaid and insurance and emergency rooms, hospital rooms, nursing homes, funeral homes, paperwork, family, caregiving. It was wear and tear, haven't you? It was overwhelming to me at times. And I thought, man, how am I going to get through this? But I was in the heat of the battle. But the things like that happen, when it gets real, and when the enemy's barreling down on us, I realized that this isn't the time to quit. That this isn't the time to surrender. This isn't the time just to throw up my hands and say, what do I do now? I had to rely on my training. And when we go through those battles, we got to rely on those trainings and things that we know. We got to trust it. And all that we've learned here at church, all the sermons that Brother Todd has preached over the years, we have to rely on that and rely on our teachers and our Sunday school teachers, learning what we were instructed. And it'll help us to get through all those things. You know, Matthew 28, verses 18 through 20 says, and Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. He says, teaching them, training them, showing them, helping them, instructing them, educating them to observe all things that I command you. And lo, I am with you, even to the end of the age. He said there are three things we had to do. Go, make disciples, and teach. And you know, I've learned in my own life, you can't teach something you don't know, can you? I mean, it's just common sense. You can't teach something if you don't know it. You know, as coaches, don't they have to know the fundamentals before you can teach somebody? You know, I mean, I can fake it for a while, but after a while, you're like, you don't know anything. You know, and as Christians, we got to know the fundamentals before we can train someone else. If someone comes up to us and asks, hey, how do I get saved? You need to know how to tell them, right? You don't just say, well, go ask the pastor. to our daily routine. He says, make disciples. You know, wherever you're around somebody, he says, talk to them about Jesus. Now, we don't all have the same realm of influence. We don't. You know, we don't all go to the same place, do we? But I'm sure we all go to Walmart, right? But other than that, we don't all go to the same places. We don't all work in the same place. We all don't live in the same neighborhoods. So he's saying, as you're going along, as you're dealing with people, as you're running into others, teach them about Jesus. You're the one that's supposed to sow them the seed. You're the one that's supposed to show them what a disciple looks like. You know, it takes a disciple to make another disciple, doesn't it? And if I'm not a disciple, how can I teach you how to be a disciple? And that's what he's telling us there. He's telling us to teach them and train them and show them what a disciple looks like. Now, I was thinking about this. Training for us as Christians began on the very first day we became a Christian, didn't it? It did. Well, when you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, in actuality, you said, here I am. Here I am. I'm reporting for duty. Teach me. Show me. Train me. You know, training has been available from the very first day that you accepted the Lord. It has been. Now, 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away, and all things have become new. Now, I like how the Living Bible puts it. And he puts it this way. It says, when someone becomes a Christian, he becomes a brand new person inside. He's not that same person anymore. A new life has begun. Now, I think how weird that. A brand new person. When you become a Christian, you're a brand new person. A new life has begun. You know, the Bible calls that being born again. Now, think about that. When a baby's born and they open their eyes, to a whole brand new existence, don't they? They do. Think about it. When they're born, they see new sights and there's new sounds and they're dealing with different textures and different smells and different sensations. They're in a brand new environment. And in this new environment, a baby begins this whole new life of change and a whole new life of growth. And in order for a baby to obtain that new life and even to maintain that normal development to survive, they got to do several things to do that. You know, a baby has to eat properly, don't they? They do. A baby's got to exercise regularly. A baby's got to be nurtured and trained by his family. A baby has to spend time with mom and dad and with his family. And that's where the baby learns. The baby learns from being around his family. From the very first day, it's new training for a baby. And it's a new journey. Now, the same thing happens to a Christian. You know, when we become a Christian, it's a brand new life, according to the scripture, where we're a new creation, all things have passed away. So the person who's born again goes through the same thing. It's a whole new world as a Christian. And in order for us to survive, we have to be pretty much just like a brand newborn baby. We have to eat properly, don't we? We have to eat the Word of God. We have to feed on the Word of God daily. And I'm telling you, as a Christian, if we're not feeding on the Word of God properly and daily, you're not going to grow spiritually as a Christian. This is not going to happen. You know, as a new Christian, we have to exercise our faith. And we've got to be nurtured and trained all the time. And that's why we have a church setting. You know, our pastor's always training us and nurturing us and showing us through the Word of God. And other teachers and preachers are teaching us all the time in our church setting. You know, we learn from meeting together. We learn from fellowshipping together. We learn from just practicing and watching and hearing the testimonies of other brothers and sisters in Christ. See, training began the very first day that you became a Christian. And there's a reason for that. Because the very first day you became a Christian, the battle started. They started even worse. As a Christian, you know what I'm talking about. The Bible tells us that our flesh wars against our spirit. That means that they're fighting constantly back and forth. You know, good and evil, right and wrong. It's all the time. So we have to learn and we have to train because those battles are starting on the very first day. Now, a good example of training and a reason for it is in the life of David. Now, David's one of my favorite characters in the Bible, and the story of David and Goliath is what I'm going to refer to now. You know the story. A giant named Goliath came out against the Israelites, and the Bible tells us in 1 Samuel 17, verse 16, it says that giant Goliath came out there 40 days and for 40 nights, and he taunted the Israelites over and over. He was there morning and night. Just like clockwork, he showed up. He said, here I am. Yeah, it's me again. I'm here this morning, and I'm going to be here tonight. I'm going to be here 40 days just taunting. But here, I want to just pick it up at 1 Samuel 17, verses 32 to 37. And this is when Goliath came forward, and he was taunting the armies, and he was trying to fight against Israel. And David said to Saul, let no one lose heart on account of this Philistine. Your servant will go fight him. Saul replied, look, you're not able to go out against this Philistine and fight him. You're only a young man, or you're just a youth. And look, this Goliath has been a warrior since his youth. See, Goliath had been training his whole life. It says that as a youth, he was out there training. So he'd been training a long time. And Saul recognized that when he saw Goliath. He recognized his training. But he didn't recognize David's training. He called Goliath a warrior. But he called David a youth. It says, but David said to Saul, look, your servant's been keeping his father's sheep. When a lion or a bear came and carried off a sheep from the flock, he goes, I went after it and struck it and rescued the sheep from his mouth. When it turned on me, I seized it by the hair, it says, it struck it and killed it. Your servant has killed both lion and bear. And this Philistine is going to be just like one of them because he's come out and defiled the armies of the living God. The Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will rescue me from the hand of this Philistine. Saul said to David, go, and the Lord be with you. See, Saul finally realized David's training. He says, okay, you've got this training. It sounds to me like your experience. Go, use that training that you have. See, we have to trust God and rely on the training just like David did. You know, when I was going through that training, and sometimes you can go through your own training at work and stuff like that, you realize, some of this doesn't make any sense to me. But later on, you kind of realize, I get it. I get why they were trying to teach me. And you know, as new Christians, and sometimes when we just first get into the Bible, we're reading some of these stories or reading some of these parables, and man, this doesn't make any sense to me right now. And sometimes it doesn't. But later in life, you kind of realize where God was showing you and what he was showing you, and it starts to make sense. See, we need to remember, God doesn't always deliver us from those battles. Sometimes God wants us to go through those battles. That's the reason he gets the glory and he gets the honor. If you read the scriptures, you see people like Moses and Joshua and all of the Israelites. You know, we know the story of Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego, and Daniel, and all these people. They had to go through these battles. And God wound up at the end of it and getting the glory. You know, sometimes we've got to go through trials. Sometimes we have to go through those sicknesses in life. Sometimes we have to deal with those pains in our spirits and in our emotions and even in our body. Sometimes we have to go through those hurts. That way God gets the honor and God gets the glory. Remember, part of the devil's arsenal that he uses on us today is fear and terror and doubt and worry and anxiety and intimidation and uncertainty and being afraid and division and all these things. And you know what? It even works on Christians, doesn't it? Anybody had any fear lately? Anxiety, intimidation, worry, doubt? Yeah, it even works on us as Christians. But 2 Timothy 1:7 says, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power and love and a sound mind. See, the devil doesn't want you to trust in the training that you've learned already. He doesn't want you to. Oh, I know I can go through this. No, I'm going to make you doubt. See, he doesn't want us to rely on our training. He even tries to convince us this time that we don't even need training. Look, I got this figured out. I can get through this. Yeah, I know I've heard it, but I can make it on my own. He tells us even sometimes, look, we don't even need to show up for training. He puts it in my mind, look, you don't need that training. By now, how long have you been a Christian? You should be a teacher anyway. Don't worry about it. You're okay. See, Satan will send things in our lives to instill fear in us, to make us doubt, to make us worry, you know, to make us feel inadequate, to make us feel even overmatched and undertrained. Now think about that. The Israelites and Saul, they felt inadequate. giant standing over there with the Philistine army, and they're standing over here, and they felt doubt. You know, they thought, well, we can't beat this guy. They were intimidated. They looked over and said, wow, look how big that guy is. There's no way we can fight him. And they felt undertrained and overmatched. You've got to think about this. The Israelites were one of the strongest armies of their day. They were well-trained and well-equipped, and there was thousands of them. And they even had the greatest commander-in-chief. They had God themselves on the side. See, but David wasn't intimidated when he looked out there. He was going to rely on his training. But he had been in training from day one. I tell you, sometimes life is scary. It is. It is. Sometimes there's some fearful times, and there's things that happen in our life that intimidate us, and all this stuff today, especially when it taunts us all the time. You know, they said that Goliath drew near morning and evening, and he presented himself like clockwork every day. He said, I'm here every day, morning and night. He was standing there taunting them. And I think that's how our fears are sometimes in our own life. That's what they do. Our fears show up every day, don't they? Think about it. Especially lately, they've been showing up every day, morning and night. Those fears wake us up in the morning, and those fears put us to bed at night. And every day we worry and fret, and every day without fear, or without fail, it happens. Every day that fear just seems to taunt us. Where's America going? What are we going to do? What's going to happen around us? Are we going to get church back again? What's going to happen? What if I catch the virus? You know, it just taunts us constantly, day and night. You know, everything else may be going great in your life, but that one fear gets you, doesn't it? It does. You know, your work may be going great, but that one little fear at home gets to you. Or your home life may be going great, but that one little fear at work, it just kind of gets to you. Have you ever been at work and your mind just kind of drifted off to a problem you had at home? We've done that, haven't we? Or you're sitting at home just enjoying your family, and all of a sudden that thing from work just pops up in your mind. You know, it happens even at church. You know, sometimes we're sitting at church, and hopefully we're listening to the Word of God, and our mind just kind of drifts off, doesn't it? Oh, man, what am I going to have for lunch? Oh, I got to go back to work tomorrow. I hope so-and-so's not there. I hope they got all that stuff ready for me tomorrow. Has that ever happened to anybody? Has it happened yet today? Be honest. I was back here drift off sometimes, but I can't. I got to stick with this. But it happens. You know, the devil gets us that way. And I know it happens. See, everything may be going fine at home, but that one little problem will even keep our mind off of church, our family, and even God. See, they saw Goliath, and they saw the fear, and they saw the word, and they saw the dread. But David saw it differently. And the reason he saw it differently was because he remembered his training. God had been training him his whole life. God had been training him up to his moment in life to deal with the Goliath situation. You know, as we just said there, he said he fought a bear and a lion, and he went after him. He said, when he messed with his sheep, he said he wasn't going to allow that to happen. God was training him his whole life. And I bet David thought there, when he saw Goliath, a bear, a lion, a Philistine, look, it's all the same to me. Because I'm trained, and I don't have to worry about it. You know, I bet you David would have made a good Navy SEAL today. I really believe that. Because he was a wild man and a tough guy, spiritually, physically, and all of that. See, all that was just training for David for this battle in his life, all through his life. Because he had a lot of family problems, if you read the history of David, to see what he had to deal with through his whole life. And even later as king, all this was just training to leading up to this moment. And I tell you, all that we go through in life now is just training for the next battle. That's all it really is. For that next hurdle or that next problem. So we got to rely on what we know. We got to remember what we've been taught and what we were instructed in and what we've learned so far in life. Look, we've been taught that I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. So we have to rely on that fact. You know, we've been taught that he said, I'll never leave you. Nor forsake yet. You know, we've been taught that God said he would supply all of our needs according to his riches and glory. So we got to rely on that, and we got to let that come back into our mind. We got to remember that God's a strong tower, a mighty fortress, an ever-present help in times of trouble. So we got to trust in that. Jeremiah 29:11 says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future." So we've got to trust in that. I mean, that's all we really have, is we've got to trust it in that fact. But what about if I lose my job? Well, what if I get sick? What if the economy goes bad? What if this happens? What if that happens? What if I can't make it through there? What if the money's not there when I need it? Well, let me ask you a question. Has God brought you through so far? Has He brought you through so far? Yes, He has. So why is this situation? Why is this problem? What, with all the stuff we're dealing with in the world, why is this going to be any different for God? Psalm 103:1-6 says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all His benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases." So is this problem that you're facing now too big for God to handle? I haven't relied on it myself lately. Is this problem I'm dealing with too big to handle? Look, if the government says you can't get Medicaid, do I have to worry about that? Because God said He's going to take care of all my needs. I didn't have to worry about all of that stuff. Did that worry and doubt and fear creep in me? Yes, it did. But I knew God was there. Remember, I said training sets us up for success and victories. So you've got to get trained. You've got to have as much training as you can, because someday you're going to need it. Guaranteed. Guaranteed you're going to need that training one day. And I'll tell you, for some of us, that day's already here, isn't it? And some of us have had to go through more and more days lately. Someone said, hope in the present is fueled by God's faithfulness in the past. Think about that. Hope in the present, the day, today and now, is fueled by God's faithfulness in the past. His faithfulness was just showing us, was just training us. It was training for you and for me and for us as a church and for individuals. It was training us for today, and the training we're getting today is training for the future. You know, God has seen us through. He's delivered us. He's rescued us. He's protected us. You know, God has made a way when there was no way. You know, God was there loving us when no one else loved us at all. So we've got to remember that training. So let me just leave you with this. How much training do you have? But the Bible tells we need to be trained. What I was saying before, we had to get trained and learn it and retain it. So how much training do you have? Are you training regularly? You know, because when you read the Bible, when you study the Bible, which is actually the manual on how we're supposed to live, that's just training. You know, when we hear the sermons or hear the teachings, that's training. You know, a Sunday school, that's training. We even have a class called discipleship training. That's training. You know, fellowship and meeting together, see, that's just training. And it's all important and necessary as a Christian. You can't miss the training, because if you miss, you're going to miss something important. You're going to miss it. Wow, I'm going to go through this problem. I don't know about that. I might have missed it that day. Look, it's all important, because training began on the first day you became a Christian, and it never ends. So we need to train and train and train some more, because someday you're going to need it. 2 Timothy 3:16-17 says, all scripture, that's every one of them, even the Psalms, all scriptures are God-breathed, or it comes from God, and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training, it says, in righteousness, so that the servant of God, or the Christian, may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Isn't it nice when you know exactly what you're doing, when you're thoroughly equipped to handle that? You know, I went to the doctor the other day, I was talking to the nurse that was taking blood, and I said, "What did you get on your blood taking test?" And she got to look at me, "What?" I said, "Well, did you get a 78 or 100? I want to know before you stick that needle in my arm." And she was kind of laughing. You know, you don't want to make somebody with a needle mad. But think about that. I want to be trained in that. See, training is what sets us up for success. So get as much of it as you can. Look, don't get caught in the battle and have to say, "What do I do now?" Hey, I'm in the middle of the battle. What do I do now? I mean, you can't pull out the phone, "Siri, what do I do now?" I'm going to tell you, do that and you hear what she says. I need that decision. "I don't know that answer. I can't help you with that." See,
my training. I do. And I thank God that for every trainer that I've sat and listened to and the things that I learned from, you know, in regular life and in my Christian life, you know, because that's what's helped me through. And I thank God even for all the life experiences that I've dealt with, because it showed me where that training paid off. You know, without training, I would have never made it in this life. Where? Before Christian and after Christian. That training is what's made me stay alive all these years and deal with all these things. I know God's will that gives life and God's will that takes it away. But it's that training that's helped me to get through. And I'll close with this verse. Psalms 119:11 says, "For I have hidden your word in my heart that I may not sin against you." See, he wasn't hiding the word in there just to keep it safe so no one could see it. He was hiding that word in his heart so when he needed it, it was there. Oh, when I'm going through this situation, all I got to do is pull out that word and remember that God said he would supply every one of my needs according to his riches and glory. When I'm going through that situation, I can remember God said he would never leave me nor forsake me. You know, when the devil starts getting angry, you're not even saved. Think about that. The Bible says, "Whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." I did that, devil. I'm saved. Thank you very much. Take your show on the road. So that's important to us. Training. I can't stress it enough. Training. Get training. And after you think you're fully trained, get some more, because you're going to learn that you're going to need it even more. If you would, let's just stand. Ms. Tina plays a song for us. With your head bowed and your eyes closed, you know where you are this morning in your own personal life. As we've already heard, we know we're all going through things right now. But you know where you are. If you're fighting a physical battle or a spiritual battle or a material battle or a financial battle, rely on that training that God said that he would stick closer than any brother. That he would rescue us. If he rescued David, he's rescued all these ones from the past. Why are we any different? Why are we any different? If you don't know this Jesus this morning, you need to start your training today. Because I really believe in my spirit that the battles are going to get worse. And that's not a negative thought. That's just being real. Thank you.
as fast food, but the drive-through. I realize, and then I think some, I don't want food with the dining room. Once somebody gets up, we need to go, we need to go find food. So it's just, we share it to everybody, and then the drive-through, and then I wanted to go get me a Zaxby salad there last week. I was going up to, not from there, but Walmart. There was one in Alabama. I get there and they're flying out all around the building, out in the parking lot. And there's some sign on the door. I'm not sure. We do drive through on it.
I like that. You know, at first I saw it. I thought that was George. I really did. You kept me the same. No, because then he came back to the system. But at first he was out there. But did you not hear it?
No.
Put some up there and sit while I'm talking to your friend.